Hello viewers, welcome to the lecture 3 of the course Industrial Robotics. If you recollect the lecture 2 where we discussed about the classification of robots, and among that we classified them based on the type of system and the type of control system. So this lecture is going to be a continuation of that. So here we are going to classify the robot based on the coordinate system. So let's see what are the various types of robots coming under this category. The first is a Cartesian coordinate robot. Next is cylindrical coordinate robot, spherical coordinate or polar coordinate robot, jointed arm or articulated arm robot, and the SCARA is a special type of a cylindrical robot which we'll discuss in detail through this course. So this is what we are going to see here, and the first one among that is the Cartesian coordinate robot. So as the name says, when we talk about a coordinate system, the simplest form is your Cartesian coordinate, where the points are represented in terms of x, y and z. X, y and z are three mutually perpendicular axes, and this robot works on this principle. So it comprises of three axes. I put it as L, L, L. So that's a notation for, you know, a joint, whether it moves on a linear path or it moves on a rotary path. So we call it as a prismatic joint or a sliding joint. So because, as I told you, this Cartesian coordinate system consists of three axes, x, y and z. So you'll have three axes, one in each, and the movement of the robo arm in all the three axes is going to be in a linear fashion or sliding or prismatic path. So now, two things. One, when we say about Cartesian coordinate robot, so it's about x, y and z. And another way of classifying it, though I have not done that in my lecture, when you say Cartesian coordinate robot, when you have x, y, z. The robot, when all the three axes, as here we talk about three axis robot, when all the three axes are stretched to the maximum extent, and the space that occupies, that space that is created is called the work volume. And in this case, in case of a Cartesian coordinate robot, because it's all x, y and z, the shape of the work volume will be rectangular. That's why it's called as rectangular work volume. Next is about the manipulator hardware and control program or the control system. So because in the earlier lecture we spent a lot of time, especially when discussing about the control system. First is about the physical structure, second is about the control system. So as far as this Cartesian coordinate robot is concerned, the control program or the control system is similar to a CNC machine. Where we have only X, Y and Z axis. So it's a, I mean, when you say it's similar to that, it's the control system is relatively simple. So this is the diagram. Here you can see there are three mutually perpendicular. This is your x axis and this is your y axis and this is your z axis. So this itself, the diagram itself tells that the construction is very simple. There are all the three, or x, y and z, are all sliding joints. So this is one commercial robot. So if you look at the structure of that, probably one thing which can come to your mind is about overhead crane or something. Probably a gantry type robot where you have frames here and you have x, y and so z axis. So this is your x axis and this is your y axis and this is your z axis. So three mutually perpendicular axis. This is a typical Cartesian coordinate robot. So this is another make from Sony. So here also you can see there are three mutually perpendicular axes, and so this is one axis and this is another and this is another. And also in this diagram itself we can see that the work volume or the shape of the work volume is rectangular in shape. So now I was mentioning about the work volume. So how do I know what will be the maximum size of my work volume? So in other words, when I say work volume, that is the area within which the robot can operate. So that is the purpose of finding out this. So if you look at this diagram, there are various terms here. Say for example, this is my vertical reach. How much height the arm can go from the ground, and similarly from the axis of that from the axis of the robo, what is the horizontal reach? So this is very important, because when you look at the specifications of that, suppose the manufacturer says the vertical reach is, it gives a larger number, so you should not get confused, because typically the robo can move only through this distance, which is known as vertical strong. And also you can see it can move only through this distance, which is the horizontal strong. This is the distance through which actually the robo arm can move, right? And now this is on the left hand side, you can see this is a top view. So one is how much it can go up and down, how much it can go forward and backwards, and what you see on the left hand side is the transverse stroke, how much you can go, right? So when you combine the vertical stroke, horizontal stroke and the transverse stroke, you will get this rectangle. So from the specification where the manufacturer says what is the vertical stroke, horizontal stroke and the transverse stroke, you will be able to calculate what will be the work volume of the robo. So this is a Cartesian robo. So here we'll see a small video of the Cartesian coordinate robo, where it is used for pick and place operations. Here also you can see there are three axes which move on a linear fashion, means it has a sliding joint or prismatic joint. And also you can see here that all three are simultaneously operating. For pick and place operation, right? So next, so when you have a Cartesian coordinate robot, what are the advantages of that? So now, because you know there are so many types and each has its own advantages and disadvantages, so you'll be able to choose one based on this parameter, that is the advantages and disadvantages. Let's see what are the advantages of a Cartesian coordinate robo. So the first one is, you know, simple algorithms are needed, because you know it's all only linear joint. You are going to specify x, y, z coordinates and how much the arm has to move in x axis, how much in y axis and how much in z axis. So simple algorithms are needed. So I'm saying simple algorithm because the next you are going to see about cylindrical coordinate robot. So when you talk about an arc or a circle, right, you know that there is nothing called an arc. It's only lines interpolated, right? So when you say interpolation, the algorithm is complex compared to a simple linear movement. So that way, simple algorithms are enough to build a control system. So that's what typically it means. And equal and constant spatial resolution. So this is a very important thing, because later on again we are going to discuss about what a spatial resolution is. So when I move in space, right, so the resolution must be equal and constant in all the three axes, in all locations within its work volume. So that's what you mean, equal and constant spatial resolution. Of course, you know, in spite of advantages, it also has a couple of disadvantages. Let's see what they are. So it lacks mechanical flexibility. So if you go back to the earlier lecture where I was mentioning, you know, you have a hand, there is no wrist as such, there is no flexibility for the hand. So when you attach your wrist, you are able to rotate it like this, twist it like this. So there is some flexibility because you have a rotary joint there. And because these are all sliding joints, the mechanical flexibility is less comparatively. And the third is, cannot reach objects to the full. That's what I said, the hand is like this. Only I bend, I'll be able to go down and reach it. When I have it only like this, I will be able to only go like this. So that's cannot reach objects on the floor. Speed of operation in horizontal plane is slower than with robots of rotary base. So it's obvious, because when you say a sliding joint, of course there is some initial friction which you overcome, only then you'll be able to slide. But still there is a constantly, you know, it keeps sliding. So when you compare that with a rotary joint, so the friction is a little bit more here compared to rotary joint. So that's the reason why, you know, it's little slower than with robots of rotary base. So next is cylindrical coordinate robot. So here if you look at the configuration, so here it says R2P, means there are one rotary joint and two prismatic joints. So here you can see, of course, though I say rotary, normally you will expect the terminology or the notation to be R, whereas here it's given as T. Why it's not R? Of course, I'll tell you later when we discuss about different types of joints. But this is also a rotary joint, and this is one linear or prismatic joint which goes up and down, and there is one more linear joint here which moves on horizontal plane. So why this name cylindrical coordinate? One is, of course, you have, it takes a circular path, that is one reason. And obviously, as the name says, when you combine these things, the work volume, we expect it to be cylindrical in shape. That's also a reason why it's called a cylindrical coordinate robot. So again, coming back here to calculate the work envelope. So as I told you, as in case of a Cartesian robot, you have a vertical stroke, you have a horizontal stroke. So these two are prismatic or linear joints. So whereas here, if you look at the top view, it is a swing, because the base has got a rotary joint. So now when you combine this vertical and horizontal stroke, which are linear, and at the base which has got a rotary joint, a swing, when you combine these things, obviously the shape will be cylindrical. So let's see in the next slide whether we are able to get a cylindrical joint. So this is what I was mentioning, where you see a cylinder, right? Of course, here you can see normally when you say cylinder, you expect a complete cylinder, and practically it's not possible. And even if it is possible, most of the cases you may not need a full circle thing. So here you see a partial cylinder. So on the left hand side is another graphically represented a cylindrical shape of the work volume. Right. So again, here this is a small video about a cylindrical robot. So you can see here, this robot is used for picking up something and stacking it in another place. So you can see that there's a rotary base, and there is a vertical movement which is linear, and there is also one more horizontal movement. So now, again coming here, what are the advantages? Because already we have seen Cartesian coordinate robo, and now we have cylindrical robo. So let's see what are the advantages this robo has. So results in a larger work envelope than a rectangular robo, because you have a swing, right? You are able to create a more work envelope or work volume suited for pick and place operations. Of course, there are a lot of videos available in YouTube. So mainly, you know, especially pick and place, because in a typical robo work cell, let's assume there is a conveyor in which raw material is coming, or a finished part is coming. So that has to be picked up, and probably the other side you have either another conveyor, or you know, there are boxes, call it as palletizing or packaging. So the robot has to pick from here, do a 180 degree rotation, put it over there. So this is, this rotary base gives that flexibility. So that's why it is more suitable for pick and place operations. And because, you know, one axis is vertical, the vertical structure conserves floor space. Deep horizontal reach is useful for far reaching operations, right? So because you're able to stretch the horizontal, the arm. So it is useful for far reaching operations. It's capable of carrying larger payloads compared to your cylindrical robot. Of course, in spite of so many advantages, obviously, you know, you cannot have any device, product or system where it has only advantages and absolutely no disadvantages. It does have a couple of disadvantages. Let's see what they are. So overall, mechanical rigidity is lower than that of rectilinear robots. Repeatability and accuracy are also lower in the direction of rotary motion. See, mechanical rigidity is lower because normally what happens when there is a structure, when you support it like this, so the rigidity is more. Instead of this, you have it supporting it on a rotary joint. So you always need a holding torque to maintain at that position, whereas in a typical Cartesian robot, since it's the design is like that, where it is supported like this, the rigidity obviously is low. And repeatability and accuracy are also lower in the direction of rotary motion. This comes because, say for example, you hold an object, in your hand. So this is a rotary joint. So after some time, there is every possibility that your hand might go down. Whereas in a Cartesian robot, it is supported like this. Right, so there is no possibility that it will go like this. So that's the reason why the accuracy is slightly lower in rotary joints. Of course, again, you know, then you cannot say that can't I use a rotary joint at all. Of course, you should be careful in a design where sufficient holding torque is given to maintain that. So configuration requires a more sophisticated control system than the rectangular robots, because you know, in the Cartesian robot, I was telling that the algorithms are simple because there is no rotary joint, means there is no interpolation. So whereas here, being a cylindrical robot with a rotary joint, the control system has to be sophisticated in order to do the interpolation. So next is about a spherical coordinate or polar coordinate robot. So again, here you can see the notation. What I have given here is, so I have two RP, means two rotary joint and one prismatic joint. So now if you look at that, first we had a Cartesian coordinate robot where there were no rotary joints at all. And in the disadvantages, we saw that the flexibility is less because there's no rotary joint. So what we did in the second step, we added one rotary joint and we created a cylindrical robot. And there also, again, you know, obviously when you say the rotary joint, there is a flexibility. So that is very obvious because you look at our human hand and the structure. So everywhere it's all, everywhere there are really rotary joints, be it your shoulder, elbow, wrist, all your these joints, everywhere it's only rotary joints, means more flexibility. Then probably you can ask a question. So if that is the case, why do you want to have a Cartesian robot? Why can't we have a robot which has only rotary axis, right? It's a good question. But then again, you go back to the cylindrical robot, where in the disadvantages we studied that the control system is little complex because a lot of interpolation has to be done, a lot of calculations have to be done. So what happened initially when it started, you know, they started with a Cartesian robot, and as technology evolved, then they kept adding the rotary axis. Of course, there were days where the control systems are very costly, and now with all globalization and mass production, the cost has come down, so we can afford to have complex control systems. Right, so now we have two rotaries. So here you can see the base. Again here, though it's a rotary joint, it's mentioned as T. Again, I'll tell you later. And there is one more rotary joint which is mentioned as R. That is actually this one. This is that rotary joint. And this whole thing, the base is rotatable. That's a rotary joint. And here you have a telescopic or linear joint. So now we have a rotary joint where the base is rotated, and there is one more, and then there is a linear. Now when I combine these three movements, you'll be able to get a spherical joint. So that's the reason why it's called a spherical coordinate robo. So now coming back here to discuss about the work envelope. So here you can see there is a vertical stroke was a straight line, whereas here the vertical stroke is given in terms of the angle, whereas the horizontal stroke is a linear value, and the vertical stroke is through an angle. And similar to your cylindrical one where the base is rotating, there is a swing. So we have a horizontal stroke which has got a prismatic joint and a vertical stroke, and the base rotates. So combining these three, you'll be able to get a spherical work volume. So this is what the shape of that. So here you can see spherical shape. Again, you know, as I told you, in case of cylindrical robo, so here, you know, it's only a partial sphere, and most of the cases we won't need a full sphere, right? So we'll see a small video here. So don't mind for the background noise. So here you can see there are three joints.
My lord, we.
So coming to the advantages of a spherical robot, because obviously you'll expect the advantages to be more because we have two rotary joints, right? So it provides a larger work envelope than the rectilinear, because another name for a Cartesian robot is rectilinear robot or a cylindrical robot. So it provides a larger work envelope, and the design gives weightlifting capabilities because as I told you, for the industrial applications, the payload lifting capacity is very important. And advantages and disadvantages, same as cylindrical coordinate robo. I'm mentioning that because you have a rotary joint, there are problems associated with that, like, you know, the accuracy, especially when the arm is fully stretched. Right. So next is about articulated or jointed arm. So in the introduction lecture, I told, you know, when you say robotic, what comes to your mind or what imagination the fiction writer had in his mind was, when you say a robo, you expect that to be resembling a human. Now, because, you know, what we want is the robot to do all the work that a human can do. So in that case, obviously, the structure of the robo has to be similar to the structure of a human. So this is exactly where this articulated or jointed arm robot comes into picture. So now you compare, you take your hand, as I told you, the shoulder joint, again it's rotary, your elbow is rotary, and your wrist, it has got a rotary joint. So we have all rotary joints, all the joints are rotary in nature. So if we can have a robo structure where you have all all the joints or all the axes are of rotary nature, then yes, you can expect the robot to have as much flexibility as a human hand will have. So now here you see the notation what I've given is it's a 3R, means all the 3 are revolute joints, which is similar to human arms. So here you can see again, there are 3 rotary joints. One is here, this is the second one, and third is this base will be rotating. So here also you look at the notations, one is mentioned as R, two joints are mentioned as R, and the third one as T, right? So again, I'll come back to that later. So this is a typical articulated R. So now here you can see from the diagram itself, explanatory. So you have the vertical reach, horizontal reach, right, and the sweep here, similar to your cylindrical or spherical robot. But the main difference between the other robots and this here, you can see there. See, the robot is able to reach its own base. So that is possible because you have all the 3 joints to be rotary joints. So that is the advantage of jointed arm robot. So coming back here to the work volume, it is also similar to that. The work envelope is of a spherical shape. Again, there are some gaps here because typically we don't expect a complete closed sphere. So now there's a small video here in a typical industry. Here you can see why robots are preferred in industries, especially in automotive industries. So the kind of flexibility, the complex task that a robot can handle, which it's very difficult or impossible by a human. So I can see that in addition to those 3 joints, the additional rotations are there, which are part of the wrist, where it is being, the object that's being lifted is turned. So this operation, it's very difficult for a human to do, holding such a huge component and moving it from one place to the other and then placing it in proper orientation. So that's the reason why robots are being used. So you have another video. So in this video, it's interesting because so in the introduction or in the definition, ISO definition for robot, I mentioned that some robots will have a mobile base, right? So in this video, you can see 3 types of robots. On the left hand side, you'll see a jointed arm robot, which is stationary or it is attached to the floor. On the right hand side, you will see a jointed arm robot which moves on horizontal base, right? It's a, you can call it as a mobile robot, but a mobile jointed arm robot. The third one at the far end, what you will see is a SCARA robot. Of course, the next one we are going to discuss about SCARA robot, so that you can see that. So here now you can see how flexible this jointed arm robots are. So I'll now play the video, you can see for yourself. So you saw how flexible these articulated robots are there, and what is the advantage of so we were discussing for each type of robot, we were discussing about the work envelope. So what happens when the robot is stationary, the work envelope is limited, right? That depends upon the length of your each link, but there is some limitation. So now, in order to increase the work volume, the robot is placed on a mobile sliding other thing, so that it's able to cover more areas. So that's the advantage of that. So jointed arm robo, obviously we expect a lot of advantages compared to your Cartesian, cylindrical and spherical, because all are rotary joints. So it's flexible and versatile. So versatility is very important for a robo, because again, go back, the definition you said, you know, it has to be multifunctional, multitasking, right? You cannot have one robo which will do only one simple task, right? So it has to be flexible and versatile enough to handle different tasks. So can easily go up and down, so being a rotary motion, the speed is more compared to a sliding joint. Can reach its base and the floor that you saw in the diagram. So of course, you know, we expected the jointed arm to have a lot of advantages because it resembles a human arm. Let's see what are the disadvantages that it has. The spatial resolution depends entirely on the arm posture. The same point here, you know, when the arm is close to your body, the resolution is more. When it is in a fully stretched position, the resolution goes down. So next is a SCARA robo. So what is SCARA stand for? SCARA stands for Selective Compliance Assembly Robot Arm. So as the name says, it's typically used for assembly purposes, so which consists of two rotary joints and one prismatic. So when you say two rotary and one prismatic, you'll expect to have a spherical robo. So the idea behind the SCARA robo is, if you observe a human who is involved in assembly operations, right? So there will be one bin here where there are components. Sometimes, you know, there will be one more bin on the right hand side or in the front. So there won't be much movement in their body as such. They'll have the hands like this, go there, pick the component, come and then assemble it. So most of the movements will happen on a horizontal plane and a vertical movement where, you know, they pick and place or do the assembly. So for that purpose, this SCARA robo is created, and you can see the work volume slightly different, or you can say it's an extended version of your cylindrical robo, right? So here you can see there is one rotary joint here, another rotary joint here, and this joint is a prismatic joint. Right. So here again, you know, though it's rotary, there is a letter V, and earlier we saw the letter R and letter T. Now we have one more called V, and what is this? Again, I'll tell you in the subsequent lecture. So this is about SCARA robo, and this is a typical SCARA robo from Mitsubishi. So here you have one rotary joint, here you have another rotary joint, and here you have a linear or a prismatic joint. So this configuration gives the flexibility. So here we'll see a small video of this SCARA robo. So you'll understand, you know, especially it is used for assembly and purpose. One plane. In this conveyor, it's being picked up on a 180 degree rotation, you place it there, right? But then look at the construction of this SCARA robot and compare it with that. The construction is very simple, very compact, especially when you say assembly, right? The space within which an assembly takes place is very small, so, right? So the SCARA robot will do a better job than a cylindrical robot. So we discussed about different type of robots here with respect to the coordinate systems. So probably this one diagram gives you the complete consolidated one. So you have a Cartesian robot where you have three linear axes, and you have a cylindrical robot which has got a rotary and then two linear, and then you have the spherical robot where you have two rotary joints and one prismatic joint, and articulated or jointed arm where you have all three rotary axes, and finally we have SCARA where you have two rotary axes and one prismatic joint, and which is mainly used in assembly and pick and place operations. So we have come to end of lecture 3 where we discussed about different types of robots based on their coordinate system: Cartesian, cylindrical, spherical, jointed arm and SCARA, and we discussed about their advantages and disadvantages. And one important thing what we observed in this session is when we have a robot which has more rotary joints, means the flexibility is more and the speed of operation is more. So thank you for viewing this lecture, and I'll see you in my next lecture. Thank you again.